Hello, good morning. Today, our guest is Professor Luigi Guiso. Hello, Luigi. How are you doing?
I'm fine, thanks. Thanks for the invitation.
Yes, pronounce your last name again, please.
It's Luigi Guiso.
I got it then. So, Luigi, today we will be answering the million-dollar puzzle in economics. Luigi, you're the expert in this field, culture and economic growth. Is culture really determining economic growth?
I would say yes, in the sense that, you know, a system of beliefs and norms that affect and regulate people's behavior matter considerably for, their economic decisions and how people cooperate with each other, how much they trust each other. And these variables are critical for, the process of commerce. They are critical for the amount of trading that can be carried over. And so they are critical for economic success. I think there is little question, and it has been long recognized as a basic ingredient for an economy to prosper is the fact that members of the community can trust each other. So trust is so basic, so critical, so enters in all potential transactions that is really a basic ingredient for economic success.
Yes, Luigi. And so years ago in 2016, and today we're in 2021. So this paper was done about 15 years ago. But in 2006, Luigi, you and your co-authors, Luigi Zingales and Paola Sapienza, did a famous and highly cited paper, "Does Culture Affect Economic Outcomes?" It's a landmark.
Yeah, that is, I think, is one of, we have a whole research agenda on this link between culture and economic outcomes. And we've been investigating several channels of influence. For instance, and also, one important dimension that we've been documenting is that these values, these dimensions of culture are extremely persistent. And persistence is important because we see when we look at cross-country comparisons that, backwardness in an international dimension, as much as economic success, seems to be particularly enduring. Countries that tended to be prosperous, let's say 200 years ago, when you saw them cross-sectionally around the world, they tend to be prosperous today as well. So, in order to be able to explain why economic success is so long-lasting, either you have very persistent institutions, and that is the the explanation that is being provided by Daron Acemoglu, or you have other type of less formal, let's say informal institutions, like the cultural norms over which people sit that tend to persist over centuries, that tend to persist over the years. And culture is definitely extremely persistent. Much more than, than institution. It's much more difficult to change the culture of a community than to change its institutions.
Yes, and this point is supported by a paper you did in 2008 titled Long-Term Persistence. And I'm going to read a part of the excerpt. "We show that the difference in social capital among towns that in the Middle Ages had the characteristics to become independent towns that to become independent, and towns that did not exist only in the north, where most of these towns became independent and not in the south, where the power of the Norman kingdom prevented them from doing so. Our difference in different estimates suggests that at least 50% of the north-south gap in social capital is due to the lack of a free city-state experience in the south. So Robert Putnam got it right.
Yeah, that is exactly, you know, what we are documenting. Essentially, that we are exploiting differences in historical trajectories across Italian cities at the turn of the first millennium. And, you know, at the time, there was a huge institutional and political change, whereby half of the country, the north part of Italy, was under the domination of the German Empire. And at a certain point, around year 1000, just to have a reference point, the empire started to collapse. So there was a political vacuum, and as all political vacuum, it tends to be filled in. And the dissolution of the empire led to the emergence of these free cities. But not everywhere and not at the same time. So many cities became self-governed, self-regulated, and they were establishing a sort of democracies, I would say, by today's standards, were not full-fledged democracies, but definitely people were participating in the management of the public good. They are participating in the government of their city. And so, you know, they were building a democratic tradition and a tradition of cooperation within the city in order to handle and to manage, the public. Other cities instead remained under the domination of the emperor, and didn't conquer this this freedom, and didn't go through this experience of democracy. And so, you know, the difference in democratic traditions across different cities of the same part of the country, that is the north of the country, provides a marvelous experiment in terms of exposure to a long period of freedom in the free cities compared to the others. And then the question is, how much of the differences in civic capital that we observe today can be traced back to these very, very important very important experience that took place, many centuries ago. And our answer is that, you know, big chunk of the difference that we observe today in the attitude towards cooperation, in mutual trust, in civic capital across the cities can be traced back to the experience of democratization that these cities had, 700 years ago.
Professor, do we know how to produce social capital? How is social capital produced?
In a sense, this experiment is telling us way of producing civic capital. Let people make decisions. So essentially, if you are able to set up a democratic community where people participate in the decision process, so the institutional design is conducive to participation, that is way of creating and fostering social capital. So in a sense, it's a byproduct of the process of organizing the decision process to handle the management of a community. And, you know, a democratic society is one that naturally leads to the creation of democracy and to the creation of civic capital. Essentially, you know, civic capital is nothing but the endowment that people have of the ability to handle common property problems, to handle social problems, to handle the management of a community. And so, you know, democratic organizations have that power. So that is one one simple answer. Then the question becomes how we set up democratic societies. And clearly there is a sort of chicken and egg problem here, because if you have already civic values communities with a big endowment of civic values, it is much easier to set up democratic and to sustain democratic institutions. So, you know, it's a difficult problem, because in order to have democratic institutions, you need a civic culture. But the civic culture emerges thanks to the fact that you have civic institutions. So, you know, it's a simultaneous type of problem that sometimes in history you observe emerging, like, you know, in the independent cities of ancient Greece.
All right, Luigi. Luigi, can social capital exist without free markets?
Social capital is definitely an important element for you know, free markets to be able to operate. And the reason is that, as I said before, you know, free markets, they require very well functioning institutions that can guarantee the enforcement of contracts. Now, think of what is actually an economy. An economy is essentially a sequence of exchanges, and behind any exchange, particularly those that entail, you know, the exchange of a good today against you know, a good tomorrow. All these exchanges, they require, they are contracts. And the contract needs some type of enforcement mechanism. Now, if you live in a society, like, you know, a court, a number of policemen, and so on and so forth. Now, if you live in a society where people, you know, are super honest, they trust each other, they, you know, act fairly vis-a-vis each other, then you don't need courts, you don't need judges, you don't need police. Everything is essentially regulated by the norms to which people conform. And that is, you know, that system of norms allows free markets to be able to operate, because, you know, it allows people to exchange. And so, for instance, I can lend money to another member of the community, being sure that the money will be, you know, the money will be returned back, and people will not default, and they will stick to their promises. So culture is fundamental for the working of free markets. Free markets are, you know, markets where exchanges are completely decentralized, and where people, you know, interact in exchange of consumption goods, or in the exchange of production services. So definitely, you know, is a fundamental ingredient. It's also a fundamental ingredient, even when you have, you know, institutions that are meant to guarantee, defend, and support those contracts, like, you know, legal institutions. And the reason is that However, well-functioning legal institutions will be always imperfect. You know, it takes time for a contract to be enforced. Enforcement is costly because you need to hire expert lawyers. And most often, it is almost impossible to write contracts that are complete, where you can describe in the contract the type of action that the counterpart should take in any specific future circumstances that could emerge. And only, contracts that are, courts can only enforce whatever is written in the contract. So if you forget about, mentioning a particular circumstances, you cannot get any legal protection. But, if you have a good cultural system, that is where these cultural norms can be extremely helpful. When things happen that you didn't mention explicitly in a contract, then good cultural norms can be extremely helpful in those circumstances.
This is a difficult question, Luigi. Free markets expand the radius of social capital, but for people to engage in market interaction, this obviously means that they trust each other. So again, we have to ask the original question, how is trust produced? This is why it's so difficult to arrive at a conclusive answer.
I mean, so there are many elements that can generate mutual trust. Some of these elements, some of these elements have to do with the quality of the institutions, in the sense that if you have a good legal system, then you tend to trust others because you get you obtain legal protection. Other features that, and this is the typical mechanism to which we resort when, for instance, there is a financial crisis, there are financial scandals, you discover that, some people were cheating others. And so you ask for better regulation, and you ask for a better legal institution in order to restore trust and give people, reassure people that, their exchanges and the interaction with others are sort of socially safe. But there are also other mechanisms that matter in that tend to produce mutual trust independently of the legal protection. And these are important because in many instances, you cannot get legal protection. Like for instance, when you go somewhere and you take a cab, you need to trust the taxi drivers that is going to take the shortest route to destination. And on that, I think you have very little control. You don't know the place, it's a novel city, so you don't know this is the shortest route. Now, with the apps, perhaps we can check, but up to recently, that was not the case. So the question is, how do people form trust in situations of this sort? Now, there are some mechanisms and that perhaps are useful to tell us what are the drivers of mutual trust. Essentially, we make inference on whether we should trust, let's say, the taxi drivers just looking at it. We look at a guy and we tend to measure the distance that separates us from the counterpart. And there is a sort of regularity that we have a high degree, or we perceive that we have a high degree of affinity with the counterpart, we tend to trust she or he more. Affinity could be, you know, in terms of ethnicity, could be in terms of place of birth, it could be in terms of religiosity, you know, elements that we share with the counterpart. And that mechanism is pretty intuitive, and is the following, that we have full trust on ourselves. So I trust myself. So by continuity, I tend to trust others that are very close to myself. So if there is a person that is very like me, I tend to think that he's not going to abuse me if I trust him. He's not going to take advantage of me if I trust. So, you know, affinity is one driver of trust. And that is the element on which often we condition in order to decide whether we should trust a person or not when there is, you know, no other piece of information available. By implication, you know, in communities that are more homogeneous, less fragmented, that are more where individuals, you know, share a common set of rules. They have the sense that they belong to the same thing. These communities tend to have a high level of trust. Instead, you know, in communities where there is much more fragmentation, either in terms of linguistic fragmentation, religious principle, ethnicities, and so on, the average level of trust of these communities tend to be low.
Research shows that individualism is a driver of generalized trust. So could individualism be explaining the variation in trust across countries?
So this notion of generalized trust is the notion of how much you tend to trust a person that you don't know. So he's a random member of a community, and apart from the fact that he belongs to that community, you know nothing else. Like, you know, my tendency to trust another Italian or your tendency to trust another American. This is an important notion because measures the availability of people to start a deal, to start an interaction, or to exchange, with a person on which they don't know anything. The higher is the generalized trust, the more you can establish distant exchanges. You know, personalized trust is a trust that you have towards people that you know, and you know people that are very close to you geographically, for instance. If you trade only with people that are very close to you, that means that, you know, you can exchange only if you are, let's say, a shepherd with the shepherds that are your neighbors. But that means that you can only exchange sheep with sheep. You cannot exchange sheep with, you know, against, let's say, a jacket, for instance, because the producer of the jacket is too far from you. So, you know, generalized trust is super important because it allows to exchange, allows exchanges that are potentially out of reach, that are far away. So it expands the scope for trade. Otherwise, if you can only trust those that are close to you, that implies that, you know, only few exchanges can be carried over, and the ones that can be carried over are not particularly attractive, you know, are not particularly enlightening. So what matters for economic development, you know, the ingredient that really can drive economic progress is generalized trust.
Yes, when you expand the radius of trust, you're more likely to accumulate wealth and benefit from innovative networks. Low trust countries are usually low in social capital, and they're often poor and corrupt. And trust also has a positive impact on venture capital formation and wide scale innovation. So if a country is diminished in trust, more than likely, it may be less likely to form large-scale business networks?
I would say yes, because, I mean, you know, if you trust only your family members, you can form a family business. If you trust instead a broader community, you can attract external capital from that community. You are not afraid of having a partner in your business unity that is not related by blood. But, you know, that allows you to attract much more, many more people, and so much more money, and allows the company to grow larger precisely because it can attract a broader set of suppliers of capital. And clearly, you know, that allows, you know, to build a broader commercial name. So I would say that that is the typical mechanism. But given that you are going to the direction of, you know, touching upon finance, I would say that, you know, this mechanism is crucial for the development of financial markets. And in turn, the development of financial markets is critical for the possibility that an economy can grow. You know, the main and one of the most important, perhaps the most important mechanism that is conducive to grow, there are two actually. One is that you need people that come up with bright ideas about, you know, to invent something that is useful for society, like, you know, the mobile phone, to start an invention. So you need a good mechanism that leads people to be creative and to come up with interesting and important innovative business ideas. And already at this stage, you know, the incentive to put effort in being creative very much depends on how much you think that if you come up with a novel idea, you can exploit it. And instead, you are not exploited by others if you start exploiting your idea. So, you know, one important ingredient is that already at the stage of thinking and putting effort in being creative, you think that you can exploit the value that your idea can generate. But once you produce the idea, the other basic ingredient is that you are able to attract the capital that is needed in order to implement your idea. And often in our economies, what we see is that creative people, the ones that have the best potential entrepreneurial ideas, are not the ones that have the money to implement them. So you need a mechanism that transfers the money from the wealthy that are potentially, you know, not necessarily the most intelligent in the world, to the entrepreneurial ones that are not necessarily the ones with the money. And that is, you know, critical to have a well-functioning financial market. But in order for a financial market to be set up and to prosper, you need that an investor needs to be sure that if he invests in a venture, the guy that benefits from the money is going to pay back the money. So for instance, you need that if I buy a stock of a company, the entrepreneur is going to give me back the money and to pay out the dividend. If I lend him money for 10 years, at the end of the 10 years, he's going to give me back the capital and the interest that we agreed upon on that loan. And so you need you know, a lot of trust in order for these exchanges to take place. So not surprising, you know, credit is synonymous with trust. You know, give credit to somebody means believing that he will pay back the money in the future. This is what the word credit means.
And trust increases the availability of ideas to the entrepreneur. When you trust more people, you get access to better quality ideas.
So if you trust, so if others trust you, I would say they're willing to exchange with you their ideas. And you know, the idea, because they trust that if they share with you their ideas, you are not going to take advantage of the information that they are passing over to you. So if you are a trustworthy person and they share a productive idea with you, if you are a correct person, you're not going to steal the idea. You are going to learn from the idea, but you are leaving the ownership of the idea to the producer, which is the guy that was sharing the information with you. So trust is important also for information sharing. You know, in communities where people trust others, people are willing to reveal information about their discoveries. They are willing to reveal information about their ideas. And some of this information are an important input for your advancement and for your ability to produce other ideas. But in order to, you know, for this process to be viable, you need to trust that if I tell you something, you are not going to appropriate the idea and exploit it directly. But, you know, recognize that I am the owner of that idea and I have the right to exploit it.
The Industrial Revolution in Britain is a perfect example of how trust facilitated business enterprises. Entrepreneurs and inventors were willing to share ideas.
Yeah, I think that is a good, I would say, is a good example of, you know, this of this process. And, you know, I don't know whether it actually was invented in England during the Industrial Revolution, but for sure in England during the Industrial Revolution, this process was materializing and was, you know, this practice was well established. Probably it was invented and created perhaps in France during the Enlightenment, but was part of a broader process among the intellectuals across the European countries since, I would say, the 16th century, whereby the habit among the producers of the ideas, that is the scientists, of sharing them and communicating these ideas to the others was, you know, was became part of the process of the scientific discovery. Now we live, particularly in academia, you know, we produce ideas, we protect our ideas, and the way we protect our ideas is that as soon as they pop up, instead of talking verbally about them with others, what we do, we write a paper so that the idea becomes, you know, certified in a sense, and then we post the paper on the internet so that it is certified that the idea was produced by me or by somebody else. So it's that process of certification that, you know, induces us to to be productive and to be willing to disclose our ideas, precisely because in this way we can appropriate them. We can show that we are the owners of that specific idea.
Luigi.
But clearly, you know, we need also to trust that others are not going to steal our ideas as soon as we put them out and make them public.
Okay then, Luigi, but even this transaction is a result of trust. I sent you an email saying, Professor Luigi, I'm inviting you to the show. You opted to say yes, but you could have said no. You more than, I don't know why you said yes, but maybe you said yes because you trust that this show is credible. You could have said, maybe the show is low quality. Maybe he's some con man who wants to embarrass academics, but you're on the show because you trust me. Why do you trust me, Luigi?
But let's put this way. I mean, I have no reason to mistrust you. Secondly, you know, I did my due diligence in the sense that I searched on the internet and I checked who is Lipton Matthews. And so I saw that you have a track record, you have a reputation. And so, you know, information can be useful to decide whether to trust a person or not. Third, I have an incentive to take this social risk in the sense that, you know, an interview is a way through which I can disseminate my production, I can disseminate my effort, I can disseminate my work, and I have an incentive to disseminate my work. So, you know, these are, I think, three good reasons why I accepted the interview.
Thanks a lot. So I guess I should say I have some level of credibility then.
Yeah, you do, definitely.
Yeah, because I keep wondering, and some of my fans and people I know keep wondering, why are these famous academics showing up on your show when you are not famous? So I just had to ask the question. Yes.
Yeah, I hope I gave you some few elements for why this is so.
Yeah, so Luigi, we're arguing that trust is related to robust financial development. Well, the word you employed in your research is social capital. This is another question. We have been discussing it, but we didn't address it in depth. Is trust also predicting the variation in entrepreneurship?
Indeed. I mean, definitely. You know, where there is more trust, there is a much more entrepreneurship. I would say, you know, first of all, there is a, let's start from the general pattern of correlation. So we see that there is a very strong correlation across countries between, let's say, GDP per capita and the level of mutual trust within a community in a country. Like, for instance, you know, countries like the Norwegian, all the Scandinavian countries, they have very high levels of trust. And at the same time, they have very high levels of GDP per capita. Countries that are backward in terms of economic development, like, for instance, Peru, they have very low levels of mutual trust. Now, there is a I would say by now, a lot of evidence that shows that there is one channel of causality that runs from trust to economic development. Now, economic development requires entrepreneurship. There is no pattern of strong growth, no country with high levels of GDP per capita without essentially, you know, a strong pattern of entrepreneurship, a ability to create firms, a high ability to have firms growing and developing. So the two things, you know, go hands in hands. There is growth only where there is invention, where there is innovation, where there is entrepreneurship. And the quality of the entrepreneurship is key for the pattern of economic development. So that is one, is the main channel through which high levels of trust transfer and translate into economic development. The other is that the high levels of civic capital, they can sustain efficient institutions. So in our economies, governments are extremely important because they are not market, they provide public services, but public services are a key for the functioning of the economy. Like, a bureaucratic organization of the state, an efficient bureaucracy is fundamental for the functioning of the market economy. The quality of the security system, the quality of the public research, the possibility of counting on an efficient welfare state. And the quality of these institutions very much depend on, on the civic capital of the community. There is a very strong correlation between, the civic capital of the community and the quality of the institutions, as we have been discussing earlier on at the very beginning. Here, the identification of the direction of the causality is a little bit more difficult because norms, strong norms of civicness can sustain good governance, but good governance nourish the formation of these norms.
Exactly. And the success of the stock market is also predicated on trust. Let me give a perfect business example. When one is an entrepreneur, he solicits funding, and one can become a billionaire without even owning 30% of his company. People who are more likely to trust investors and who do not oppose to sharing their company with others will become more affluent. There's a lady who works as a consultant, and their client wanted an investor, but the investor was interested in acquiring a percentage of the company. Yeah. And as a result, the lady who was being served by the consultant said she had no interest in the investor because the investor wanted to appropriate her company. This is a stupid response to investment. Today, the investor is no longer interested in the business, and this lady is still soliciting funding.
Yeah, I mean, so as I said, if you want, if you mistrust a company and the company requires capital, in order for you to be convinced to put the money in the company, what you ask for is a little bit of control because you want to monitor what the company does. So you are willing to enter the company only if you acquire a share of it and you can sit in the board, okay? So this is on the side of the investor. If there is a relatively limited trust, you only enter willing to fund the company only if you get a sufficiently large share that you can exercise some type of control. So you need to monitor your investment and to sit in the board. Now, on the side of the entrepreneur who requires capital, he also requires some level of trust in order to let the guy in. So you are the entrepreneur. You need more capital. You would be willing to get more external funding and to let the guy in, provided that you trust the guy. So it's not, you know, you are unwilling to do so if the guy, besides bringing money, he also brings in troubles and may try to appropriate the whole company and kick you out. So mutual trust in this case is needed on both the side of the entrepreneur that needs to acquire, to attract more capital in order to grow the company larger, but also on the side of the investor that needs to trust the entrepreneur, and in order to do it, is only willing to do so if he can get some rights of control, some possibility of monitoring how the money is used. Now, if there is a little trust on both sides, what happens is that, you know, the exchange is not going to take place, the company will stay smaller, the investor will not be able to invest optimally his money, and so he has to put it in in a deposit of a bank at a relatively low rate, and the economy will not grow, will not expand, will not develop.
Exactly. So I'm not an American. Mistakenly, you said your fellow Americans. I'm actually a Jamaican. I live in Jamaica. And Jamaica is a low-trust country. Today, some people are more inclined to trust the stock market, but there are those who even work in business, and I've met people in finance who will say the stock market is a scam. And there are also individuals in business who don't scale because they're just too afraid to share their ideas with prospective investors. So I can give you studies and real-life anecdotal examples to indicate how the paucity of trust hampers business formation.
Yeah, I mean, that is exactly true. You cannot fully trust a company in the sense that once you give, let's move a little bit of a step backward. So all financial exchanges are exchanges of money today against a promise that you get the money back in the future, possibly with interest or dividends, okay? So if you invest in a company, you are giving the money to the entrepreneur, to the current owner of the company. If you buy a stock, you are transferring money to the company, and in exchange, what you are getting is a piece of paper. It's just a promise that in the future, you are entitled to get the dividends of the company, okay? But in order to be willing to give this money to the entrepreneur, you need to believe that in the future he will pay out, that he will pay the dividends. Those dividends will be available because he will be using the money in order to make the company larger. So that is, he will be investing the money. If you think that he will be hiding or running away with the money, you're not going to invest in the company. So you need a lot of trust in order to be willing to enter into these type of exchanges. Now, in the case of stocks, the issue is particularly important. Because essentially, when you buy a stock, you are giving full discretion on what to do with that money to the entrepreneur. So the entrepreneur is the person that decides how to allocate that money, among alternative projects. And you become a little bit an owner of the firm, and you share fully the risk of the firm, including the risk that the entrepreneur runs away with the money. So it's the most, it's a type of investment that is really super trust intensive, because you give full discretion on what to do with the money to the entrepreneur. And so, you know, even relatively frequently, some entrepreneurs cheat on their investors, that is super damaging, because it's killing the willingness of investors, trust even sometimes honest entrepreneurs. So one important issue is that, you know, the bad behavior of an entrepreneur can spill over on the others and can contaminate the trust that, you know, people have on entrepreneurs in general. So for instance, suppose that you go to a mechanic because you need to repair your car, and the mechanic cheats on you. You're going to revise your opinion about the trustworthiness of this mechanic, but presumably, most likely, you are going also to revise your assessment of the trustworthiness of the whole category. So you will revise the trust that you have towards mechanics in general. And so, you know, trust has a nature of a public good. And so the behavior of each single producer, the correct behavior of each single producer, is important, because otherwise it can spill over, can affect the ability of the other entrepreneurs, the honest ones, to raise capital in the market.
Luigi, yeah. Since we're on the issue of trust, I'm going to mention COVID. You and your fellow co-authors recently did a paper on COVID and social capital. Is COVID affecting social trust?
Probably, yes. I would say almost surely, in the sense that you don't know who is a carrier of the disease, okay? So if you meet two people randomly on the street, or let's say in a room, and you don't know them, and you don't know anything, the only thing that you don't know is that, you know, COVID is around. Clearly, you become more prudent in interacting with others, precisely because there is a chance that now the person could be, a carrier of the disease, and it could be contagious, and you could potentially contract the disease. So I would say that yes, you know, people have become much more prudent in their mutual social interactions, precisely because of the disease.
I frequently wonder, how will the impact of COVID on generalized trust affect innovation?
That's a good question. I mean, the process of innovation, my impression is that probably may not be a super important issue. So in the sense that innovation usually pays off over several years. So true innovation activity is not something that, you know, you start thinking today, and then tomorrow you pop up with an idea, and then the idea can be brought to the market. It's a very long process. COVID, I think we understood it, that it lasts for a certain number of years, but it's relatively contained. You know, we know that these epidemics, looking at the past, 2 years, and then they are essentially gone. So my expectation is that the process of the incentives to innovate shouldn't be destroyed by the experience of the pandemic. Now, there could be other many other channels that may potentially, you know, matter for establishing a link between COVID and the incentive to innovate. In some instances, I would say that the incentive to innovate has been strengthened by COVID. Like, you know, the need, first of all, to discover a vaccine, you know, COVID was prompting innovation. And we know that two of the most important vaccines are the really big innovations from a medical point of view. And that is thanks to the fact that there was such a huge pressure, you know, dictated by the need to survive, that led, you know, Pfizer and Moderna to produce a vaccine within a relatively short lapse of time.
So to forestall the risk of a pandemic, macro innovations may be accelerated, whereas micro innovations become slower. A pandemic is a big risk, and big risk require groundbreaking innovations. So you mentioned vaccine, and there are other examples. So maybe COVID could accelerate macro innovations, but slow micro innovations. This is a topic that you could study.
Yeah, definitely. That is, I think there is already research that is going in that direction. I think what COVID has brought about to the attention of the public is the fact that the probability of a pandemic is no longer zero, as we thought, at least in Western countries, up until 2 years ago. Now there is the idea that this probability is far from zero, and probably it tends to be magnified by the environmental transition and the problem of global warming. So I would say that this is going to most likely to create a wave of innovations that are pushed by this higher probability, by this higher risk, definitely. So Lipton, I have 2 minutes because then I have to go.
Yeah, I'm planning to wrap up too. And this is the last question, and be brief. What drives women out of management? The joint role of testosterone and culture. Be very brief because we both have to go.
You mean women?
Yes, that paper you did.
So the idea is essentially the following, that we know as a fact that there are fewer women entrepreneurs than men. A long-standing debate that has become much more important in the recent years, whereby you see that there is a huge gender gap in entrepreneurship. And particularly when you look at firms at the top of the sales distribution, you see that they are managed by men, essentially, particularly in certain sectors, like, you know, in finance is a typical example, where most of the CEOs of big financial players tend to be male rather than female. But even, you know, among relatively small businesses, the entrepreneurs tend to be boys rather than girls. So the question is why this happens, and how we can, try to identify a role for cultures. Now, one explanation is that women are less talented for entrepreneurship, but that is is not acceptable, is not true, can be easily rejected, in the sense that there is nothing that is specific, so specific to entrepreneurship, that requires boys rather than girls. But until you have proved it, you cannot dismiss it. You know, the other explanation is that women are out of entrepreneurship because we think that women are not adapted to perform that type of jobs, or because our social organization assigns a certain role to women and a certain role to men. So they say, you know, women cannot be entrepreneurs, so they should stay at home. Or like in Saudi Arabia, women cannot drive cars and do they should do something else. They cannot be taxi drivers. That is a social norm about certain roles should be related to genders. And we know there is nothing in terms of ability, because women can drive cars as much as men. And we see that if you look at the Nordic country, where women are as much taxi drivers as men. Probably it's a job where there is, you know, the composition is kind
All right. So Luigi, you have to go. So I'm just going to get to the point and read the findings. Women managers show more masculine traits. Therefore, when women are promoted, they tend to be more masculine. And the proportion of women among managers is higher in countries with higher women emancipation. You have to go. I respect your time. So I'm just going to allow you to go. But thanks for your time, Professor.
Thanks.
All right,
thanks.
Then. Yeah, man. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.